this morning's Sunday school banner went to the elementary class with a tie between the elementary and the teen class. Both had 106%, so they both did a great job. All right. Did we have any birthdays celebrated this past week? Anyone celebrate a birthday? Who are you looking for? Oh, yeah, they're not. We might have to go back and revisit the birthday. Maybe we'll have a whole bunch of wedding anniversaries by the time we get done. How about wedding anniversaries? Did we have any wedding anniversaries celebrated this past week? Well, we'll go back and revisit so Ezekiel gets to come up and put his money in. All right. I do have, before we get started, a card I'd like to read. I'll post this back on the bulletin board there in the foyer. It says, "Thanks so much. The phrase is simple and the words are few, but behind them is a whole lot of appreciation from the Betty Lewis family. Says, thank you for all of your prayers and thoughts during Betty's illness. The food that was prepared for her, Betty would have really enjoyed it. We thank everyone." This is from Betty's family. And I'll post this on the bulletin board. We have several announcements I want to go over. And the first of which, I want to recognize Sharon and Virgil and Connie and Evelyn and everyone that responded over the past weekend with the funerals that we had and the homecoming meal. They did a great job in that kitchen. They worked. I told Sharon that one more day, I thought law required that we had the health department inspect and we had to put a sign up for a diner. But they did a wonderful job. I felt it was necessary to put that in the bulletin, but certainly I think it's necessary that we just give them a little round of applause to show them our appreciation. A lot of hard work, and they did a great job with everything. Revival went really well, had an average of 31 people each night, and most of those were us. So I'm tickled to death with that. Don't know why we were down with visiting congregations. Lebanon Green did come out the last night, was the biggest visit we had. I think they brought 8 or 9 people with them. So glad to have them. Thought it was good revival, some good messages. Certainly want to thank Harold and Gary and Chris for the song services that they led. And Melissa also had a special there Wednesday night. We appreciate that. Oreo cookies. Next weekend, if memory serves, is the Chicken Festival. The camp will be having a food booth there at the Chicken Festival. And Locust Grove shift for that is Saturday from 4 o'clock until 8 o'clock in the evening. If you're able to come out and help with that, and you don't have to stay there for the full 4 hours. You can just come out for an hour, a couple hours. That's great. Any help would be appreciated. We've been taking up Oreos because one of the things they do there is the deep fried Oreos. And we've got a Laura Grocery donated 2 cases, and we've got a few more packs out there. So if you plan on donating a pack of Oreos of any size, please have those in here by this evening's service. And then I'll be sure and get those to Mackenzie so they can get up to the food booth for that. And if you're able to help, that would be great too. Also, mark on your calendars next Sunday. Sharon and I was talking how quickly things move. It's time for the Gideons to come as well. So Gary Steenbergen will be here speaking on the 24th, which is next Sunday. He's the president of the Corbin Camp of the Gideons. So I look forward to hearing his presentation. So certainly mark your calendars on those. Now on to the prayer list. We'll first go over what's in the bulletin as far as updates and then anything new we may have. Wilma Carol Johnson, we had her on there for eye surgery. She had the surgery and received good results on that. George Carnes III, listed there, UK hospital with cancer. Passed away, so the family of George Carnes. caudal, back injury. He had surgery, is that correct?
Yes.
It went well and no fusion was necessary on his part. And then Frank Carnes, who had been scheduled for an MRI, had that, and he just got really good test results on that too, and he thanks everyone for their prayers for that, and gives the Lord all the credit. Mike Worley is now out of the ICU, and he continues to slowly improve. They've moved him out into a room, and it'll be a long recovery for him, but he is improving in that area, as well as Leland McFetridge, from what I understand, is out of the ICU and into a regular room, and he is improving also. Glenda Clark, we had her on the prayer list last week. She's had an MRI. She got good results also. So a lot of prayers and praise there. Joyce Owens is in the hospital with an infection. Raleigh Messer will be having a biopsy on Monday to check on another spot. And then Sue Ann Owens, she's awaiting results of an MRI, and I think Bob said that they're hoping to get those results this week. She's just having a terrible time with her arm. Bob said the only relief from the pain she gets if she's laying in the bed with her arm down to her side straight. If she tries to move it or from any position in what we would call like a sling position, the pain just radiates in her arm terribly. So it sounds like probably a nerve problem in her shoulder or something. But certainly, let's keep Sue Ann in our prayers. Do we have any new prayer requests or any new updates?
Mackenzie and I spent about 6 hours in the ER Friday. She has a 2-millimeter kidney stone that she has still not passed. And then Sheila Shiro, which is Rhonda Carr's sister, I talked to Rhonda on Wednesday, which was the day Rhonda was supposed to get two Vanderbilt.
Uh-huh.
Sheila had to come off all or a lot, if not all, of her medication before they started the stem cell, and then it caused her spleen to become enlarged, so they would not start that procedure. They're hoping they can reschedule it to the end of the month to get her spleen.
So they have rescheduled the stem cell.
Postponed, yes.
Postponed.
Due to the fact that they can get her spleen down.
So Sheila Shiro, due to an enlarged spleen, they have postponed that stem cell transplant. Any others?
Rodney's home.
Rodney Wood, update there. He, after how long?
6 weeks.
6 weeks in the hospital. He has, he's made it home too. So good news there. All right, looks like he's asleep. Do we want to do the birthday thing, Hannah? Ezekiel celebrated his first birthday. And he's so tired from all the festivities, he's still asleep. Certainly, it don't seem like it's been a year, but certainly a blessing for that as well. All right, any other prayer requests, announcements, anything needs to be made before we continue on the service? Well, certainly, let's keep these folks we have mentioned in our prayers. Not forgetting, of course, those are on the shut-in list. Also in the military, and then in the mission field, and of course, all of the families that's associated with those as well. This morning's opening Bible reading will be done by Brother Harold Bales. And then our morning prayer by Brother Harold Johnson. And so if you would, please stand for the reading of God's Word and remain standing for our prayer time.
I want to read about four more verses that is listed on the book. So beginning with Psalms 95, verse 7. Verse 1. Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with songs. For the Lord is a great God, great King above all gods. His hands are the deep places of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his own. come let us worship now and bow down, let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness. When your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my work. 40 years long was I grieved with this generation and said, it is a people that do err in their heart, and they have not known my ways, unto whom I swear in my wrath that they shall not, should not enter into my rest. May God have his blessings and grace in his word.
Amen.
Dear Lord, our loving Heavenly Father, we come to thee this morning just asking your blessing on the service. We hope and pray the words we will hear will just help us to just grow as a Christian. And I hope that it will just help us to continue to build on your holy word that we've got started. And we just hope and pray that maybe one word may be said that will cause us to just kind of dig into your holy word and seek some more interesting stuff that you have put in there for us to read. And we hope and pray that all these things that we find out will only show us that we are true and faithful Christians. We just ask that you'll be with our service people the world over. I know it seems like we all the time are sticking them out in harm's way, but we just ask your blessing on them and hope and pray that you'd be able to reach down with your loving hand and just get them out of some bad situations that they happen to be facing. Just be with the ones that's on our prayer list, and we just hold them up to you, and we hope and pray that you just reach down for your loving hand and touch them and allow them to be able to come back to church one more time while they still live here on this earth. And if they happen to not be a Christian, we just hope and pray that they will become a Christian. And just help us all to have just better communities and just a better world for us all to live in, where we can all just associate with each other and just show our love for each other and not all this bickering and backstabbing and fighting and carrying on. If we can't get along on earth, I don't see how in the world we're going to all go to heaven. So we better be straightening up our plans down here on earth before the time comes around that we stand before God again. Just be with God, Brother Robbie as he stands before us this morning. Hope and pray that you would just give him the wisdom, the words that will just help us to just make us a better person. And hope and pray that when we go out into the world that we will always let our light shine and let them know that we are Christians, that we stand firmly for Jesus Christ, who died on a cruel and rugged cross just for each and every one of us today. Just lead God and direct us as we go on through the remainder of this day. In Christ's blessed and holy name we ask all things. And amen.
Amen.
Graduation with our class last night. page number 308, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you.
Lord, that we're able to lift up your praises in song and to study your word and to especially, Lord, gather around this table to remember the sacrifice that Christ made. The love that was poured out at Calvary's cross that we might have salvation. And I pray, Lord, as we take this loaf and this cup, that we would remember that broken body and shed blood. Strive to walk closer in his example each day, looking to you for guidance and seeking your forgiveness when we fail you. I pray, Lord, that you would go with us through the remainder of this service and find everything that we do pleasing in your sight. These things I pray and ask in Christ's name.
Heavenly Father, once again, we just want to thank you and give you the praise and honor and the glory for allowing us to assemble here this day. We can assemble once again this side of judgment, that we have an opportunity to make our lives closer to you, be a better example for you. One here does not know you, that they can turn to you before this life, everlastingly, eternally, too late. We just thank you for Jesus and what he did for us when he suffered, bled, and died. His blood cover our sins and give us the promise of eternal life. Be with us as we partake of that broken body and spilt blood in remembrance of what he did for us. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. left and those that have not, in Jesus' precious name I pray, amen.
Church, looks like Miss Hannah has got them, so 12 and under, you're dismissed for that. While we're heading over for Children's Church 177, I surrender all. We are hymn of invitations, Lord. Certainly good to be here and have everyone out. Visiting or guests with us, invite you to be back anytime you can. It's always a privilege for me to share God's word with you and continue in his study. This morning we will look at something that in one way or another we probably all can relate to. Sometimes we know that God's ways tend to confuse us. Sometimes we go through painful situations. We might even go to the point of questioning God sometimes. Deep down inside, though, I think we probably know that he always has what's best in mind for his children. And we know what the scriptures tells us, that all things work together for good for those who love God. Well, sometimes we don't see that in bad events. And I'll use, for example, the most recent is the Harvey and Irma. Those destructive storms. We know it killed several, the number of people it killed was in the hundreds, and the property damage was certainly in the billions on both of those storms. And we just don't see initially, especially if you're a victim of those, how there could be any good. But, and I think I talked about this briefly the other day, that how good can come from bad. You know, the nation was torn apart, protests, people, all you could hear about was racism and Confederate memorials before those storms, and now we see the opportunity and we see that people have turned to help. And we see that suddenly it's what we're focused on is the things that are most important. Now, I want to take just a little moment just for a sidebar. I don't know if you keep up with the weather or anything, but there is another hurricane on the same exact track as Irma. So certainly be in prayer that hurricane does not hit in the same way as Irma did. Because certainly they're having a difficult enough time as it is. But we see that good can come from bad. Racism was replaced with compassion. I don't know if we got good can come from bad. We'll see here in a slide shortly. We can't always, and we're going to start by looking at when we see God act, but sometimes we miss his purpose. We can't always see where the road leads, but God promises that there is something better ahead if we just trust in him. Genesis, and we're going to look at some instances from the Bible. And the Bible is full of these, especially in the Old Testament. And I encourage you to go back and read in your Old Testament. Genesis 50. Verse 20 is the point scripture I want to use. Joseph says here, "But as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day to save much people alive." Well, we remember about Joseph, don't we? Is his father's favorite, made his other brothers jealous. They eventually sold him into slavery, which put him in Egypt, first with Potiphar and then serving the Pharaoh himself. And even at Potiphar's house, when he was his servant, his wife, we recall that. And he made choices that landed him in prison. And because of that, it put him in contact with the baker, the wine cupbearer. Remember that portion of the story? And he foretold their futures, and it came true, and that one of them ended up back at Pharaoh's court, and then we know the rest of the story. Because of all of the bad things that happened to Joseph, God provided that Israel would be saved in a time of famine. So we see Joseph's acknowledgement that as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day to save much people alive. Why would God allow such things to happen to this young nation of Israel? He was preparing them. They were his chosen people, but he still knew that he had to prepare them for the coming eventual birth of the Messiah through Jesus, our Savior as well. Why do we ourselves go through difficult times? Why do we experience times that we would think would be unjust because we hadn't necessarily done anything wrong, but yet it seems like something bad happens to us? Oftentimes we're able to look back in hindsight and say, I see now why what I was being prepared for today, though I didn't understand it at the time, though I didn't enjoy it at the time, though it was difficult for me at the time, though I questioned God at the time, I can see that just like Joseph, God had a bigger plan in mind. I think we can all probably see an event like that in our lives. And that's what happens. We see God act, but we misunderstand his purpose. And understand that there's a difference between what God will allow and what God intends. God allows hurricanes. He made the weather patterns. He allows hurricanes to happen. There was some, I could use several adjectives, but I'll be kind. There were some ignorant people that said that hurricane hit Houston because of who they voted for. And that's ignorance. Ignorance. God allows things to happen. And certainly there was a lot of loss of life. There was destruction. But there was also good stories. We talked about those before. And we've seen people react. And we've seen compassion of Christ. Because it wasn't just good people. It was Christian people reacting too. I'm not saying that's all that reacted and come down there, but a good number of them were and still are. We see God act, but sometimes we miss his purpose. And when we forget God's purpose, our next point, there's a danger there because you'll fall into disobedience. Sometimes when we get overwhelmed, we forget how big God is. Judges chapter 2 verses 8 through 10, and we'll see something here. Again, if you're not familiar with this portion of scripture, I encourage you to read. It says in Judges chapter 2, beginning in verse 8, "And Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old, and they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the mount of Ephraim, on the north side of the hill of Gash." Now pay attention real close here. "And also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers," which means that they died, all of his contemporaries. "And after them, and there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which had done for Israel." They forgot. They failed to teach. After Joshua died and all of that generation that had passed, now remember who That will be the generation that was delivered out of Egypt. Remember, we just talked about Joseph, and we've seen that putting Egypt in bondage, so to speak. Then Joshua passes away, and after all those who had been brought out of Egypt passed away, that generation, then there was a generation of the children of Israel that did not have a clue what had happened. And whenever that happens, it's bad. Death of a great leader, falling away of obedience of God, just in a couple of verses. Because we know what a mighty follower Joshua was. But just in those two short verses, we see the rise and the fall of a nation, basically. They went to worshiping idols and served them instead. Began to chase after their own lust instead of seeking out the pleasure of God. And we can see in many ways how that mirrors our country. We were once more righteous than we are. I'm not saying that we don't have righteous people in the United States, but I'm saying we are drawing further and further away from that with each generation because of failure to teach. And that's what we see here. If there's a generation right after Joshua that didn't know, it's because somebody didn't tell them. And we see the results of that in our nation. And I think that there are people making strides to go back to that. We're trying anyway. Because I believe we see the results when we take God out of our society. It has negative results, and that's for sure. So we know that disobedience to God will bring about judgment as well. That's all throughout the Old Testament in the nation of Israel. And we need to see those things, but we need to see something else as well. That God uses bad people to bring about righteousness sometimes. In God's hands, intended evil becomes eventual good. And that would be that's a quote from Maxwell, but that's something good for us to remember. In God's hands, intended evil becomes eventual good. And I'll cite this. Remember Herod and Herod Antipas? Remember those two guys? One of them we read about every Christmas when we read the Christmas story and how he wanted to seek after the young child which was born so that he might worship him, as he said. Well, we really know what he was doing, don't we? He was seeking him out to kill him because very shortly after the wise men left Bethlehem, he sent word to go kill every child 2 years of age and under. And then his son, Herod Antipas, as he continued to struggle for power and to manage the Jews in the light of the Roman occupation, the death of John the Baptist, and also, I'm sure, contributed to the capture and execution of Jesus. But we see for a fact that even though these men intended evil, God's plan of salvation was played out. He was not able to kill the child. And if he had any hand at all in having Christ crucified, then that's exactly what God's plan intended and required. So that salvation might be brought to all people, not just the Jew, but to everyone that would claim Christ as their Savior and follow what the scripture tells us to do. It's carried out by bad people, and we see that happen sometimes as well. Prophecy fulfilled through the hands of people that we may not even think about. Poor leaders inspire believers sometimes. God will use a poor leader to inspire believers. How so? Verses 4 through 20 of Acts. I'm sorry, Acts 4, 20. We recall after receiving the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, Peter and John were in trouble because of what they were preaching. The priest told them that they wasn't supposed to do anything in the name of Jesus. They were mad because of what success the Holy Spirit was moving. They were preaching, they were healing, people were getting saved. They were told not to do anything in the name of Christ, and what was their reply in Acts 4:20? We cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. That was their reply. Poor leadership in the church. That would be kind of like the board telling our youth group or Sunday school department not to teach Jesus. That's how ludicrous that is. Not if it didn't come from the pulpit, then it wasn't authorized and it wasn't sanctioned and it wasn't necessary. And not to do it anymore. And them having success in doing it. It makes no sense to do that. We cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. Even in the light of this poor leadership, even in the light of men that wanted to suppress the spreading of the gospel of Christ, and they, remember, these were the leaders of the church, the same leaders of the church that had Christ crucified, the same leaders of the church that witnessed his resurrection after his death and burial. And tried to hide that as well. Never acknowledging the fact of who Christ was, even up to the point that seeing Christ preach and the result of all of that, and still trying to say he's a false prophet. Poor leadership can inspire believers. Persecuted church is a strong and active church. What would we do in this country? What would we do in America? Heaven forbid, that's when I say this, that Congress pass an act that says it is no law, it is illegal to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in the United States. Would we just stop? Would we shutter the doors here? Or would we come back Sunday night, next Sunday, next Wednesday, and continue to do what we always have done? We cannot but speak of the things that we have seen and we have heard as Christians, regardless of what the leadership says that we are supposed to do, because who is our ultimate leader? Who is it that we are ultimately accountable to? It's God, isn't it? So we have to model what Peter and John did here. We have to first and foremost be able to stand and say, we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and which we have heard. Hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ in message and in song. Seeing? What have we seen, Rob? Well, we've seen a lot of prayers answered. The power of God moved throughout this congregation. We've seen people that should have died that didn't. We've seen people that should have gotten bad test results and they get great test results. And I don't think that that's just by coincidence. I think that's by the hand of God. So we cannot but speak the things that we have heard, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the things that we have seen, answered prayer and experience. Maybe even we've been the benefit of those prayers. So we have to do that in spite of poor leadership. And we also have to understand that God uses awful events for his future plans. I think this is the one that didn't show up too good. In that bottom picture shows destruction from the hurricane. I apologize for the poor picture quality. The top picture shows two white men in their boat helping a black family out of hurricane destruction. Now, before those hurricanes hit, if you turn the television on, or the way I took it anyway, I don't want to try to interject your feelings. But if you turn the television on, you would think that every black person in America hated every white person in America, and every white person in America hated every black person in America. That's what the news seemed to be driving to me, that there was this great racial tension, and that at any given moment, if we had the chance to do evil to one another, we would. That don't look like evil to me. That looks like people helping people regardless of skin color. And I think that's exactly what Christ would have us to do as Christians. Because God loved and Jesus died for people of all colors, all races. It doesn't say anything in there about that. Sheep and goats only has to do with those that are saved and those that are not saved. But that's what we have to recall. That awful events, it's awful. I'm not justifying these hurricanes. I'm not justifying the destruction that's come see the reaction. I am pleased to see that the media cannot deny. They can't spin this to be bad. The millions of dollars that's being given by people just like you and me, the aid that's being sent down and rendered by people just like you and me, they can't spin that. White people helping black people helping white people, Hispanics helping the same thing. They can't spin race on that. And that's good, because God is using this awful, awful events of these hurricanes, but we're seeing good come from it. We're seeing America being America. And we're seeing, in many cases, Christians being Christians. Now, Acts chapter 7 gives us another awful event. Verses 54 through 60 in this, and you're familiar with it. Once we start to read, you'll say, oh yeah. It's the martyr of Stephen. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. That's starting in verse 54. But he, obeying, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. And then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their coats at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Here's another example where we see the world attack and try to intimidate God's church. And we see Stephen here, an early leader, who preached a sermon, who infuriated the religious leaders, which ultimately led to his death. But we also see something else. Saul, just a kind of like a bystander. He's standing there watching. He's not an active participant, but he is present. And they lay his, and I think that the picture there, we see the coats laid at his feet. He's standing there watching. And when I was typing this up, I was thinking about Saul and the effects of that. And I don't know that there's probably not any of us here that have seen things that we wish we have never seen, because you can't unsee it. I know I've been that way. There's things that I've seen in my life that I can't unsee that affect my decisions that I've made for the future. And I think Saul standing there, and you think about that, I mean, that's a gruesome thing. I chose that picture even though it's an old picture. You know, you see the guy standing there behind Stephen. He's got a big rock in his hands and his hands above his head. And you think about what a brutal thing that would be. And I'm not going to go on and get more graphic, but we know what happens. I mean, if you stone somebody with you throw rocks and you beat them with them until they die. And we could imagine what a gruesome, I mean, Saul could not unsee that. Period. An awful event. And I just wonder how many times through the next days and weeks that scene played out in his mind. I wonder what he was thinking whenever he was on the road to Damascus and the Lord, he met Jesus there also. How did that influence him, do you think? I mean, we know what he felt. He was a righteous Jew. I'm not saying that he was on the right path, but he was doing what he felt was right. He couldn't unsee this event, an awful event of a young preacher preaching the gospel. They silenced that by his death. And then here we see that Saul, on the road to Damascus to do probably more of the same, is stricken by the Lord to be called into his service. time he can't unsee what that he witnessed with Stephen. But we can see now, because we have that hindsight that I talked about earlier, how that God can use awful events in our lives to produce something in the, that's good in the future. Imagine if Saul had not been standing there. Imagine if he did not see that scene that he couldn't unsee. Would we be gathered here today? Because we know that Paul became the greatest evangelist for the Gentiles, began to spread into Southern Europe, and it's because of that Southern Europe and Southwestern Europe that we have the benefit of the gospel today. And I fully believe that it began there at that moment when Stephen was killed for preaching the gospel, and he witnessed and saw that this man's faith was so strong that he would not deny and even prayed for the forgiveness of those who were killing him at that time, that it affected him far beyond that day. God uses awful events. Evil religious leaders, a young, growing church we see here trying to be stamped out unsuccessfully. And what we have to remember is this, that the ways of God is perfect, and we cannot possibly understand all that he does. No way. I'm the first to admit that to people. They ask me sometimes about difficult times, and all I can rely on is the examples that I have from the Bible, but I am always there to tell them God's ways are not my ways, and I certainly do not have the mind of God, and I can't see the future. But I have faith that in the future, something good will come out of that. You know, we use the old saying, every dark cloud has what? Where do you think it comes from? If a cloud is dark and we're in that dark cloud, usually there's a silver lining if we look for it. And there's a reason behind that. We see that here. God loves us so much that he will use all things. He will use all people to fulfill his eternal plan and his eternal purpose. And that's what we need to be reminded of occasionally. And that's what we need especially it is our duty when we encounter someone that is in that dark cloud and they can't see the silver lining. That's where we get the opportunity to step in and say, hey, look, I was there once in a similar situation, and here's what happened in the end, in the hindsight of this. So just hang in there and stay strong and be faithful, because God is going to use this for good eventually. You're going to look back and you're going to say, oh, that makes sense now. And that's why I want to encourage you this morning. That's why I brought this sermon this morning. Was because I know that maybe some of us here today are in that dark cloud right today. No doubt in my mind, there's somebody probably here this morning or on YouTube that will watch that's in a dark cloud. Hang on. Stay faithful. There's a silver lining. You may not see it tomorrow. You may not see it next week. You may not see it next month or even next year, but it will come eventually. Now, maybe you're going to encounter somebody this week that's in a dark cloud. Remind them. We've studied enough stuff this morning here that you can talk intelligently. That's what I always try to do, is try to talk. If I don't talk about a subject, that means I don't know enough about it to speak. But everybody here this morning knows enough about this subject, you can speak. So if you have that opportunity this week, do that. You got to study his word. You got to spend time in prayer. You got to live in obedience to him. And when you do that, you have the opportunity to be that encouragement to someone that's going through that dark cloud. And realize that God uses wicked to achieve his plans, just like he uses good. Just like that rain that fell, the rain falls upon who, the Bible tells us? The just and the unjust. In other words, that rain fell on good Christian people that weren't doing anything wrong at all. just like it fell on the worst people that our society hosts. It was indiscriminate. And in the same way, those people received the compassion of people that cared about people in need just the same. Who would that make us think of? Jesus, wasn't it? In the same way. See, God can use awful events, bad things, to accomplish good. And the main thing is that, the main thing, that the plan of salvation would be preached and taught, and people's lives might be changed, so that they would know Christ as their Savior. And it's the responsibility of every one of us to share that good news. It's the only message that keeps people from going to hell. We realize that we're the guardian of that. Christians has the only message that will prevent someone from spending eternity in hell through Jesus Christ. And I know it's not very politically correct to talk about people going to hell, but I didn't see anything in there that told me I was supposed to be politically correct either. It offends me to think about people going to hell. Worse than it offends me to think about hurting someone's feelings. Where are you at this morning? Are you here today knowing Jesus Christ as your Savior? And if you said no, you don't have to leave here today that way. You don't have to leave not knowing who Jesus Christ is and the power of salvation that comes through his sacrifice. If you have heard the gospel and you believe it, and that belief and hearing has affected your heart to where you feel the need, the conviction to repent of your sin and know that you need a Savior, Jesus Christ is that Savior. Confess him as such. Make that public expression through baptism where you die in the likeness of his death and you're raised in the likeness of his resurrection. You will receive forgiveness of sin. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And then you are charged to walk faithful until Christ returns or until we're called to obey death. Maybe you've done that. Maybe you have already committed to that. But you realize, you know, I'm not committed to what Rob's talked about. I've always looked at things differently. Instead of looking for the silver lining, I've looked for something else. I've never encouraged someone to do that, but I'm going to do that starting today. That is great. That's the intent of the message. Make that change if it's necessary. We're going to sing the first